Sorry.
Please, question.
Well, I promised asking a nasty question. So basically, rather to the breaking up silicon nanowires. So the time scale between NB simulations and experiment is 10 orders of magnitude. So how can you be so sure that half the dislocation at ATM is just brittle behavior?
The brittle behavior is clearly seen on the strain curve. There is no any plastic flow. You have linear increase of stress and then drop. So there is no any plastic flow region. And molecular dynamics, of course, it's only for like a nice cartoon in this case, because temperature is different. Temperature is different and time scale is different. But as material scientists, I believe in stress strain curve. Once you don't see any like plateau or plastic strain, you can be sure that it's really brittle fracture. Because when we do this bending, we saw actually the plateau. The strain is increasing, the stress is not.
It was room temperature, right?
Room temperature. As far as you consider that electron beam doesn't hit your structure, so this is room temperature. It actually doesn't. So you can be sure it's 20 centigrades inside TM.
Please, question.
I understand, yeah.
I understand that your task and your purpose is to measure materials as small as possible. My question is a little bit opposite. How thick layers can be treated with your technique? I can explain probably later why I'm interested in it.
Yeah, it depends on the material, but the maximum force we can apply using these holders is 10,000 newton. So it means, for example, for carbon nanotubes, which are hollow, we can work with rather big structures. It could be like 300 nanometers wide. But for very like tough materials, like for example tungsten wires, it could be like not more than 20 nanometers, because you cannot break these structures. And unless you don't break, you have not enough information. Apart from Young modulus, maybe. Young modulus you can determine. But usually we work with a scale of something 20, because when you go to very small structures, that's another problem. You cannot see much, because your human eye is not that sensitive to like 1 millimeter or something.
What is the accuracy of your Young modulus determination? Because it is well known
that, for example, nano indentation is highly unreliable, so it really can give you whatever.
Yeah, but as far as I remember from my university course, if you do tensile tests, this is the most accurate determination of the Young modulus. Not compression, not bending tests. We determine by using tensile tests. Because we can very precisely analyze displacement by using high resolution, and we can very precisely analyze the force, because we have a sensitivity of the sensor, something like 2 nanonewtons. With this precision, we can be sure that we really measure the right number. And of course, there's some error bar, which usually is something like 5%.
And can you vary temperature?
We can using this Joule heating, but unfortunately, by using Joule heating, we cannot. We know the temperature is high, but we don't know how high, because these holders are not compatible with normal heating stage. For heating stage, you need to have some like spiral or some disc, which is resistively heated. But in this case, we are working in free vacuum. We cannot put any heater inside.
Question, please.
Я прошу прощения, я по-русски буду, и прошу мне ответить тоже. Скажите, пожалуйста, какая минимальная длина, с которой работает сегодня материал ведения?
Длина?
Да. Ну, размер. То есть это одна нано, 10, 100 и так далее.
So I repeat the question for foreign guests. So the question is, what's the minimum length scale you can get information from? I would say it depends on your skill in this case, because in my experience we were able to. Sorry, you asked to answer in Russian. Все зависит от ваших как бы возможностей, ваших рук и ваших глаз. Что вы можете увидеть и как вы можете приблизиться к этой структуре. Значит, я сказал, в моем опыте самые маленькие частички, которые мы могли изучать, они были всего-навсего 5 нанометров в диаметре.
5 нанометров,
да.
То есть это вы можете видеть все-таки атом, а не электрон?
Нет, ну я сейчас говорю о вот испытаниях инситу. Если вы говорите об обычной микроскопии, да? Об обычной микроскопии. Обычной микроскопии сейчас уже видят индивидуальные атомы, допустим, даже водорода. Индивидуальные атомы. Вы можете даже видеть какие-то стриппинг, связанные с электронной плотностью на картинках, но.
Нет, но там электронная плотность, но не отдельный электрон, правильно?
Нет, отдельный электрон пока еще.
Отдельный электрон мы не видим. Ну, это на самом деле проблематично, существует или нет. Спасибо.
Okay, can I just translate to our focus? So I said that the minimum length scale in my experience was something like 5 nanometers, but the question was can we see individual electrons? I said no. Because it's too early.
Maybe a question.
Is it possible to see surface chemical reaction with gas pairs on your games?
Yes, it's possible, but we also have, I didn't mention, we also have some, it's called environmental holder, where you can put inside a TM column ppm quantities of different gases. You can do it, but usually microscopists don't like this experience because once you put some gas inside the column, the next user should wait like 20 hours to bake out the whole species. But we did so. We did experiments that, for example, for this environmental TM, we hid it. We were trying to analyze how boron nitride nanotubes are growing. So we put boron and we put nitrogen gas inside. And the temperature was 1000 centigrades. That's possible.
Okay. But my question connect with transformation crystal amorphous phase. Yeah. What do you think about? Can you estimate some pressure in this region?
Yes, we saw this transformation in silicon nanowires when we compressed them, and I think the estimates you need gigapascal range.
And ferrum.
When?
Iron. Yeah, iron.
Iron. For this transformation, there is no pressure. No pressure, because.
Yes, but because we have. Nanoparticles nanotube.
Yes, that's a good point. But we specifically chose the crystals which are half filled, so you still have the room for expansion. If you compress the crystal from this side, it expands on the left and the right. If you do this experiments for fully filled tubes, of course the pressure can be. I measured this pressure could be 4 gigapascal. 5 gigapascal, you can put that huge pressure on the crystal. But that was another point, because there are some well-known high-pressure phases of iron, of cobalt. This is just ambient pressure. That's a point. We just got these materials because of very fast cooling rates.
As we probably all know, in the atomistic simulations, one of the biggest effort is always put in providing, if you don't do first principles calculations, of course, in providing the reliable and high accuracy force fields. So with the precision this high, as you showed us now, can you provide any data in this respect in the interatomic force measurements?
I think this question better to ask the next speaker. I'm not from theory part. I'm responsible for experiments, and basically I collaborate with many theorists all over the world, including Arkady and Pavel Dmitry, Boris Jakobson, a lot of people, and they always ask me some experimental data in order to make the calculations feasible. They always ask some parameters, of course, the length scale, the time scale, the temperature, but I'm not responsible for the accuracy of the theoretical calculations.
So, is it at the present state of experimental techniques, how much atoms can you measure the force on?
I think it's a
huge
number,
right?
Yeah, it's a huge number of atoms. It's not just not one, not like for theoretical calculations. So.